welcome, church. Welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome. If you are new or visiting, it's great to have you here with us today. Please come and grab a seat. Please come and grab a seat. And today, church, whether you're here with us today or whether you're watching from home, I pray that as we continue in Mark's gospel, that you'll be blessed as we jump into this. And if you want to read with me, we're looking from Mark chapter 10, verses 35 to 45. Mark chapter 10, verses 35 to 45. And I'll share that with you now. So let's have a look. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. "Teacher," they said, "we want you to do for us whatever we ask." "What do you want me to do for you?" he said. They replied, "Let one of us sit at your right hand and the other at your left in your glory." "You don't know what you're asking," Jesus said. "Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with?" "We can," they answered. Jesus said to them, "You will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. But to sit at my right hand or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared." When the ten heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their higher officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this word, and we pray that as we delve now into it, you would illuminate our hearts and minds. Help us see what it is that you have for us to take away from your word. Help us come with a heart and mind and spirit of expectation that you would transform us in this time we give to you now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Right, so Mark's gospel is a very interesting gospel. Look, Mark's gospel honestly challenges readers to ask who Jesus is. That's the purpose of Mark's gospel. It's a purpose we put out there. Who do you say Jesus is? Now, this should lead to more questions. It should lead to more questions if you take it seriously. If you just become dismissive of it, you won't have any questions. If you take it seriously, it must lead you to other questions. As C.S. Lewis put, he said, "Jesus, he's not left the door open. He's not left the door open for any patronizing." I love that word. No, not any patronizing argument for Jesus just being a good moral teacher. And he didn't intend to. That's the first point. There is no scope, if you read the Gospels, to come with any patronizing argument that Jesus simply thought of himself as a good teacher. And he didn't intend to. Now, the thing is, as he says, you can either call him a lunatic. He had to have either been crazy for what he said he was. So you can call him a lunatic, or he was a very gifted con artist, or he was possessed. Somehow he was possessed in the things that he was able and capable of doing. Miracles, not recorded just only in the Bible. Josephus also recounted, a Jewish historian, recounted Jesus doing miraculous works. So maybe he was possessed. Or he actually was who he says he was, and that's Lord, God Almighty. Now, the thing is, depending on what you agree with in one of those, it has consequences. So you can dismiss him for the first three. Has no consequences or bearing on you whatsoever. However, if you even dare to think that it is the last, that it is the latter, it will have to change how you live. Simply put. Now, we've covered a number of Jesus' claims, and we've found that Jesus' view of himself, these claims, were incredibly different in his understanding as to what they understood them to be. And so they also became extremely divisive, even to the people around him when he first said it. This led people, some people, to follow, many others to leave. It was just simply too divisive. It asked too much of them. And so some of the claims that we have then is Messiah, the one sent to people to spiritually free them, not politically to free them, to spiritually free them. King, the one present at the beginning of creation, who now says, I've come as a suffering servant. Son, the one whose identity is affirmed with, to, and through those he serves. The Son of God comes to serve, he says. And today, we're looking at the title of ransom. Now, those first hearing the idea of ransom, if we have it up on the screen here, they would have understood the idea of a spiritual ransom, doing something practically to pay a spiritual ransom, but only as an offering. Could I have that next slide, please? As heard in Leviticus. Now, so they understood this idea of spiritual atonement as a ransom. It's what you did for that to happen. However, Christ would bring a very different atonement in another way. As you'll see, this atonement was still needed. Can we have it up on screen, please? Was still needed, but he's saying that only he could offer the sacrifice because it was God in the flesh. An atonement without the defect of sin that chose to offer himself on our behalf. We're getting into the weight, you know, the meat of what Mark's gospel is about here. So today, paying a ransom might look very different. It means one person dictates the terms to another. I dictate the terms to you for you to retrieve something back which I have taken, stolen, whatever. But I now get to dictate the terms which you have to choose whether you will agree to or not. And I'm guessing that it would often be of something of great worth if I am able to dictate those terms. Now, who's seen this movie? Anyone? This morning at the 8 o'clock there was 2 people. Now there's 4. Okay, good. We've grown 100%. It's a great movie. It's got action, drama, power play. It's about holding people for ransom or information. It's the negotiating. There's this tussle. And it's the idea of who will gain the advantage or win the game of negotiation. Now, Jesus' disciples, even the Jewish people, and I think even us today, I think we prefer drama, power play, negotiation. I think we prefer that. And the reason is because it means that we feel we can control the outcomes. We prefer it. We want to control life and perhaps people around us. Jesus doesn't use power in the way that we do to negotiate or control outcomes. The way he does so is through humility. And so my first point is this. His ransom requires humility. Humility from that God offered and that we are also asked to offer. Humility nowadays is a common moral. Most of the time associated with Jesus. Sometimes people associate it with, you're a Christian, you should be more humble. It's generally when they want something out of you. Have you noticed that? Yeah. Don't push into traffic. Be more humble. That's why I have a motorbike. I don't have to worry. I can just go through the middle. It's not an issue. But in his book, Humilitas, John Dixon, he reviews a history of humility. Really good book. I encourage you to read it. And he discusses the idea of humility upon society and how we've been profoundly transformed by this virtue. But in the first century, that wasn't the case. Humility was not a moral which you sought after. If anything, you were seen as weaker. You were not someone of virtue if you had this quality. For those who follow Jesus, it was then extremely peculiar that he would associate the kingdom, the power of God, with humility. And that this would be a principle for Jesus to associate the representing of God's kingdom coming. And that for God's kingdom to come, required the people, the servants, the children of God, to display a similar quality. Jesus has now spoken of his death three times. He's talked about it. He talks about how choosing to humble himself to death, and that only in him could he offer something in exchange, for what God requires. Now, we know this weighed very heavily on Jesus. It weighed very heavily on him. And so he details what was coming. He does this to show that there is a price that has to be paid. And he says that this was happened long ago. It was prophesied long ago. There is a price that has to be paid for a ransom for what we have done as humanity. And that this would require a physical price. It couldn't just be about rainbows and unicorns and you know heartfelt lollies, and you know, it's not like all nice things. He said there's a price. And when the disciples hear this, though, they respond as you'd expect. They're mortified. How is it that the power of God requires humility and death in such a traumatic way? The Greek word for amazed is thombos. It's like an amazement mixed with fear. The other word for afraid is phobos, where we get phobia from. It's like a raw fear, amazement mixed with this raw fear. It might be like this, you know, if you're feeling, when you stand on a sky deck, you know, thousands of meters up looking down. I love it when you, have you seen the one where they have these panels and they make it look like it's cracked, like you're about to drop through? I'd like to do that to someone. You know, maybe we could have something around here. No, anyway. But you see, Peter, his amazement with this raw fear led him, though, to reject it. He was shocked. He was not only shocked, rejected. He was disgusted. He was disgusted with the idea that the Messiah would die on a cross. Peter didn't believe. He said, it just cannot be true that humility, rejection, suffering, and death is God's plan. Maybe you feel like that today. It can't be God's plan for me to have to experience this, go through that. Surely it can't be God's plan. Peter later appreciated what this would do. He just didn't believe at the time, in the midst of it all, that Jesus had it right. And for this, Jesus rebuked him. He got rebuked because he led with his plan rather than submitting to what God's plan was. Perhaps we might struggle with the idea of Jesus' death. Do we believe God wanting to allow Jesus to die in such a traumatic, humiliating way? Do we actually believe that God would require that of his son? And if we struggle with it so much, do we kind of just say, I can't share that message? God surely can't require that of his son. Or have we become immune to it? Have we heard the story so much about Jesus dying and going through such a traumatic thing that we simply aren't amazed or have a raw fear of it anymore? Does the thought of God paying such a price still bring you a sense of fear and amazement that God would do this? Or have you turned off to it? Next point is this: his ransom is for you. Yesterday, I took two friends around the church building, you know, beautiful building, talked about the history, and they were blown away with it. How good is this? 200 years of history. You can see it in the pews, in the bricks. As you go underneath the, if you don't know about it, we have like this kind of underground thing. What do we call it? What? Cellar. The wine is not kept there yet. It's like a baking oven. I found out recently that one of the older ministers and his children, when they used to live in the rectory, they used to use it as their pistol range. So next time you go under there, I'm sure you want to go under there, look for the bullet holes. Anyway, that's a bit of a tangent. Anyway, I was telling, they were blown away by the history. And it made me think and reflect on this. You know, if we keep hearing about how awesome the church is, our history, look at it, so much to engage with. What kind of reactions do we have? Do we become apathetic to its historical importance? Have we just gotten so used to it? Ah, it's just the building. Do we get overwhelmed by what's needed to look after this place? It's just too much. I just want to turn up and get out of here. I don't want to have any ownership for my church. Do we turn off? We're not interested. We get tired of hearing about it. I don't want to have any vision for its future. I don't care who comes after me. I don't want to set them up for a win. Or can we have a love for it? Appreciate the thousands of people over 200 years that have invested in it. And so we want to see a future. We want to set the next generation up for a win. We want to invest in this place and bless them for that. What response do we have? You see, sin translates as our failure to fulfill a goal. Sin keeps us from loving God, loving others, but also living into the ideal of who God created you and I to be. God desires more for us as his creation than we do. He desires more for that person sitting next to you than you do. The sin of Adam and Eve was to set themselves apart from God and say, I can do it by myself, God. I don't need you. And so this imparted to humanity a nature of disobedience. The result is we are born into this world spiritually dead. And this is why Jesus said to Nicodemus, you must be spiritually reborn. To remove that disobedient nature that only I can remove. God's wrath wasn't against Adam and Eve any more than it is against you and I as an individual. God loves us so much. He loves you, and I hope you hear this today, whether you're here or whether you're watching. God loves you so much that even in the midst of your sin, he gave himself through Jesus as the penalty for our sin. Through himself, so that through the cross, he could overcome that spiritual death for you and I. And for all of humanity, He's already done that as a gift for people before they've received it. And so when we were dead in sin, the cross cancels our debt. But to let Jesus be our ransom means we are asking him to disarm the spiritual powers of evil that accuse and bind us, and to let us be spiritually reborn. We are allowing it. How many of you feel that you have accusations, that you feel that you are bound up in so many spiritual, emotional, physical things? How many of your friends and family are bound up by these things? And there's that last song, the song we played, we're going to speak Jesus over our friends, family, society. To speak it is to call God's authority and to live God's authority to break accusations, bondage, all the things that bind society. Amen? God loves us so much that through Jesus, he chose to take responsibility for your failure and my failure. How do you feel that gospel message might be received by your friends and family today? That the love of God looks like God choosing to take responsibility for all you have done wrong, that you are doing wrong, and that you will do wrong. God chooses to take that responsibility. Is this a good news that you can share? Or is this a good news you're just going to keep to yourself? This frees so many people. You know, there's even better news though. Jesus says, if you die to yourself and be spiritually reborn, I'll not only take your sin and shame, whatever you are feeling, experiencing that is binding you today, I will take that, free you from that, and together we will do great things through your life, together. So here's our next point. His ransom leads to greatness. Now here's the thing though. We don't measure our transformation or our greatness the way humanity does. We don't seek it the way the world does. We measure it by God's standard. We ask God, what is your vision for me? What's your vision for me? What do you want me to look like as your child? Many of us have done that with our children, right? When we have our children, we have so many different dreams for them, what they can become. The world is just open. It's an opportunity. God does the same thing with you and I. Even as we grow, there's still so much that he says, I want you to live into. I have so much for you. Now, if we named inspirational people, we might think of those who create things we use, have changed social structures. We have it on screen. There we go. How they've overcome great odds, or maybe they've just given us great life quotes. Especially like, hard work never killed anybody, but why take a chance? But James and John's attitude, as we heard today, their attitude to greatness was this: do for us whatever we ask of you. Grant us to sit with you in glory. Jesus is about to enter Jerusalem. They think he's going to make a power play. They seem to disregard that he's just talked about his death and what that will mean for him. Great friends, right? At the point that he really needs the greatest support, they focus on themselves. When the other disciples hear this, they're angry with James and John, not because they go, you guys were just way insensitive. It's because they got in first. They got in first to try and get some seats of honor. They want to make greatness about themselves, even though Jesus has given them authority to do supernatural acts of service for others. Instead, they want the miracle to be about themselves. I resonate with this. I'm guilty of this. How often do I want my supernatural acts of service that God works through me to end up being more about me than about the person that I've got in front of me? Wanting what can encourage or be for me rather than God, what are you doing in them? How do I bless them? For them to know your presence in a deeper, transformational way. But we do this. And so here's a key point I want to share with you as we close shortly. If what we want, regardless of how long you've walked with Jesus for, if what we want is more important than Jesus, then no matter how long or how close we've walked with him, we can still miss out on what Jesus wants us to do and what Jesus wants to do in us. It doesn't matter how long you've walked with him. If you still keep making life about what you want, you'll miss out on what he's doing for you or in you. But Jesus patiently teaches the difference. God's leaders do not wield power over others. They wield power and authority to serve others. You see, James and John and the other disciples, they will be ridiculed, and many of them will die for their faith. But they will say it was worth it. Jesus' teachings have turned the world's principles on its head. Humility has led to exaltation, suffering to joy, rejection, acceptance, death equals life. It spun everything on its head. Has it done that for you today? My heart is desperately that each and every person would know the humility of God that gave himself as a ransom so that you would live, and to know true life. Is it any wonder that John Dixon said that Jesus and his disciples sparked a humility revolution? And I just wonder, how many of you have a cross that you wear today, or you've got a cross at home? It's a peculiar symbol to celebrate. But I want to encourage you, let your cross remind you that you are called to be a peculiar people, to wield God's divine authority that redefines what greatness looks like. Yours and my challenge is, can we live up to what God's called us so that we may continue that humility revolution? I want to pause and pray for us now, that we may follow in the footsteps of people that have done so for thousands of years in following Jesus, that have been faithful. Even in this place, for 200 years, people have been faithful to follow him, that they have shared God's love in such an inclusive way that even the worst of people have known that God's washed away their sin and that they've found rebirth in him. So let's pause and pray now, that we may be bold enough to continue the work of Jesus' revolution today. Let's pray. Lord, I just thank you that the humility of the heavens, the humility of God, transformed our world, not by power or overthrowing political or military structures or social structures by making people follow you, but simply serving the people, your creation, giving your life as a ransom to show this is how much God loves each and every person, has transformed our world. And so we ask, Lord, that you would empower us, let us be bold enough to continue that revolution in sharing your humility in such a passionate way that our friends, our family, and our community come to know how much they're loved by you and how much you've done for them through the power of the cross. This we pray in Jesus' name.